right? Turn to the book of Jude. It is on page 994 in your church Bible. Amen. The book of Jude. Now, we are launching into a multi-week series on stewardship as we are kind of preparing ourselves for this next phase of ministry, another year of being able to serve together. It is my hope and prayer that we can, in many respects, be in a very unified and coordinated space where we understand that there's a shared responsibility we have in taking care of the work of God. Amen? Amen.
Somebody.
Amen. God's been trying to find Jude. I know. It's right before Revelation. All right? So Revelation is the last book of the New Testament. Amen. And if you just go to Revelation 1 and maybe flip one page before, you'll find it. And they have it on the screen. Amen. So if that's just all too much exercise for you in the morning, amen, then just turn your attention to the screen and you can read them all. The book of Jude, amen. It is thought to have been written by the brother of Jesus, whose name was Jude. How many know Jesus had a couple brothers? Now, these brothers were not conceived by the Holy Spirit as was Jesus was. They have the same mother, amen, a natural mother, earthly mother, if you will, Mary. And then, of course, Joseph is the father of both James and Jude. And if you read the book of James in the New Testament, that is authored as well by James, the brother of Jesus. And this small letter is authored by Jude, the brother of Jesus. Both of these brothers were very leading officials in the church in Palestine, probably in or around the vicinity of Jerusalem. These were some very, very Jewish kind of men, meaning that they had a very high regard for laws, for the kind of Jewish traditions. And yet they also were very aware that there was something very powerful and unique about who Jesus was. They all were very much aware that Jesus was indeed someone who was actually changing all of the rules. And I don't know if you've ever had the hardest converts in your family or your family members. I don't think you've ever had that kind of experience. How many of you have unsaved family members or folks who are not necessarily believers? Amen. And isn't it interesting that it's easier to witness to folk who are outside your family than folks who are in your family? You ever had that experience? Amen. And they're always willing to, like, you know, bring stuff up from back when you was young, you know, or you was at the family reunion last year or last month or last week or yesterday. Amen. And remember all the ways in which you kind of, you know, made some mistakes or whatnot or did something that was uncouth, if you will. And they always have an ability to bring up some drama, some falling short. I think in many respects, James and Jude were in the kind of constellation of disciples who made some decisions to follow Jesus, were probably some of the last folk who came on board. Because they remember Jesus when Jesus was a kid. You know, maybe Jesus, you know, took a little wooden toy without asking, you know, pushed him out the bed in the middle of the night and did something that, you know, it's like, you can't be the son of God because you did me dirty. Somebody say amen, right? But eventually they came around, and that's just a little bit of an encouragement for some of you. Keep living right, keep loving your family members, all those folk who find it hard to believe you changed, because eventually they will come around. Give me a high five and tell them they're going to come around. They're going to come around. And so we have here in this passage a very powerful expression, Jude. If you read the whole book, I mean, I can, you know, take a whole lot of, and I could probably preach it just, I was reading the chapter, and I was like, wow, there's a lot of stuff in this passage that I can really spend a lot of time unpacking. But I was drawn to this passage, particularly because of the last couple verses. As we are launching a series on stewardship, I think it's always important for us to start with the ultimate steward. And the ultimate steward is certainly our God, amen? The one who takes good care of us. So let's take a look in here at this passage, and we'll get down to the end where most of our preaching will come from today. But the scripture says, but you Beloved, must remember the predictions of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ when they said to you, in the last time there will be scoffers indulging their own ungodly lusts. It is these worldly people, devoid of the Spirit, who are causing divisions. But you, beloved, build yourselves up on your most holy faith. Pray in the Holy Spirit. Keep yourselves in the love of God. Look forward to the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. And have mercy on some who are wavering. Save others by snatching them out of the fire. And have mercy on still others with fear, hating even the tunic defiled by their bodies. Verse number 24 is kind of where the meat of our preaching will come from today. Now to him who is able to keep you from falling and to make you stand without blemish in the presence of his glory with rejoicing, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the glory, majesty, power, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. Word of God for us, the people of God, let us say thanks be to God. All right, so we're launching a season of preaching and teaching on stewardship. We are going to spend the next month or so just kind of really talking about how God is wanting to make sure we take good care of that which is left within our charge. But to start off today, amen, I'm kind of moved by, amen, the Word of God to encourage us to stop tripping. God's got your back.
Amen.
All right? Tell them, stop tripping. God's got you. God's got you. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless the Word of God that has been read for us. The people of God, we ask you to hide this word in our heart so we will not sin against you and send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me and you, the hearers of this word, in the name of Jesus, we pray. Let the people of God say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Don't trip. God's got you. It's one of the greatest tendencies and predilections, if you will, of the human makeup or composition is to view ourselves, listen to this, and everything we have through a lens of deficiency. Meaning that we are shaped and taught and conditioned to believe that whatever we have and wherever we are, it is not good enough. We might have 10 pairs of shoes, but we still like, we need just that one more because it goes so good with our outfit. We have a place to live, a house, but we still feel like it's too small. We got a car, but we want a couple more. We got a girlfriend, but fantasize about having a little bit something on the side. Our society operates off the narrative of scarcity, meaning that we tend to be moved by a fear that what we have presently is not enough. Or we are worried that what we need may not be available to us without us having to do some very sophisticated machinations, manipulations, all these kind of workarounds and schemes, because many of us feel like there's not enough for everybody to go around. So rather than trying to figure out how to take care of what we have, we are often distracted by the dreaming up of those things that are just beyond our reach. And this month, I want to challenge you with this notion that God has given you and I all we need to do not only his will, but to live the kind of lives he's called us to live according to his unique purpose and design. The child of God must always remember ended up in some places that we don't even know how we got there. I wish I had a church in here today. Just think back of some of them places. You ended up in that position and you know you were not qualified. You got that A on that test and you know you did not study. Matter of fact, if you got the test tomorrow, you probably flunked. Somebody say amen, right? Amen. Or you made every single, dotted I, cross T, made every decision you thought was right, and you still found yourself in the middle of a mess. That your own power and your own wisdom and your own goodness and your own strength does not necessarily guarantee you the result that you want. That at some point you have to acknowledge that God is involved in making sure that my life is up the way He wants it to be. I know for us modern people that's a hard pill to swallow because we love the illusion that we are in control. I mean, we love the illusion. And we'll build our life on that illusion. But anybody ever built your life on something that was quicksand? Lord, I'm gonna talk to y'all for a few minutes and say, I think y'all got a post 4th of July stupor up here. How many remember the story of Tarzan, amen, flying on ropes, amen, only fella, white guy in all of Africa, and he just dominates Africa. And you go through the woods, or it's not the woods, in Africa was the jungles, praise God. And you go through the jungle, and you try to obey lions and snakes and elephants, and all of a sudden you run up on something, and you put your foot on it, and it starts to give way. And the more you try to get out of that giving way ground, or dare I say that quicksand, what happens? You actually start to sink further. On the surface, it looks just like regular ground. But underneath the surface, there is a chasm, a lack of substance. There is no foundation, and it starts to drag you down. Child of God, when you live your life on your own terms, unaware of the ways that God is intending to take care of you, I want to submit that you are living your life on quicksand. That you may think that you're on solid ground, but there's a step that you can take that will start to bring you down to a place where you're going to have to holler out for some help.
Yeah.
Anybody ever had to holler out to God for some help? Lord, I need your help. Part of what I want you and I to appreciate as we move throughout this month of stewardship is this awareness that God wants you to take good care of all the blessings He's given you, but it must flow out of this awareness that, first of all, God has committed to take good care of you.
Yes, okay.
God has that no matter what's going on in your life, God is not going to allow you to be left up to the circumstances of your life. But when you start falling and sinking and finding yourself in a place and a position of vulnerability, the message and the word that I hope comes up in your mind, you need to stop tripping. Because God's God. You're back. Let me first define stewardship a little bit, just in case some of you may not fully appreciate or be aware of the deeply biblical rootedness of this whole concept. In the Old Testament, a steward was understood as one who oversees a household. They served as greeters and house managers, hosts, and animal caretakers. They were managers and administrators. They were responsible for taking care of things, listen, that they often did not create on their own. A steward was given an assignment, and sometimes it was temporary, sometimes it is permanent. But the truth still remains that the oriented connotation. New Testament believers were taught to be stewards over God's mysteries and the richly diverse grace of God. Stewards were set up as positions in the church to help structure and organize the gifts that God has given to the world. So, in the biblical text, particularly in the Pauline letters, you see a structure of stewards with different titles. Bishops, apostles, deacons, evangelists, pastors, teachers, all the gifts of the Holy Spirit were given to the church as an aid in the stewardship of the body of Christ. And as you can see, there are multiple ways in which stewardship is employed. Listen, but it always revolves around taking care of someone or something. Now, what is so fascinating about how the church has, I think, lost the concept of stewardship is that many people believe that titles are given so people can serve them. But I want you to know that when you get a title, I don't care what your title is, you are to serve those who are in your charge.
Yes.
And service is not necessarily abdicating you of authority, because Jesus, I think, was the most authoritative figure in all of history. But when Jesus came, he said, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but I came to serve. Now, ain't this something? I don't know where some of us get leadership and stewardship so perverted, where we think that when you get a title, all of a sudden, you're supposed to have folk who serve you. And it seeps out in all parts of our lives.
Yeah.
You got folk who have elected positions, and they forget that they're there to what? Serve the people.
Yeah.
They think that they've been anointed the king, the duke, the prince of Berkeley, San Francisco, California. And how dare you come and tell me how to do my job? I am the mayor. Well, guess what, brother, sister, mayor? Your position is in service to those who have given it to you. Wouldn't it be something that every follower of Jesus really believed that, whether I am a CEO or a supervisor, that I am trying to figure out how can I serve you better?
Come on.
Stewardship flows out of this awareness that service is the highest form of leadership. And what is our paradigm? It is our Lord. It is our God. God did not, create all of these frameworks and positions and even his own witness by lording it over one another. But the scripture says that you who would be the greatest must first become a servant. Now, I feel like I have to spend a little time on this, because for the rest of the month, we're going to actually be very specifically talking about how you can be a better steward of the gifts that God has given to you. Everybody say time.
Time.
Talent. Treasure.
Treasure.
And your temple.
Temple.
Say it again. Time.
Time.
Talent.
Talent.
Treasure.
Treasure.
And temple.
Temple.
You have been called to be a steward of how you spend your time, how you use your talent, how you invest your treasure, and how you deploy your temple. And child of God, how many of you know when you are confident that God is giving you all that you need for your time, talent, temple, and treasure, you will be a steward of it differently. When you begin to really appreciate that, God, I'm not worried about overstretching myself in this way, because I believe, God, that as I steward, as I serve, as I lead, my help is not coming from me or from from other people, but as I do your will, my help comes from the Lord. In a basic sense, then, if we were to define Christian stewardship, we should understand it as the process and practicing of sustaining everything that God has given to us. It could be a person like your family, your friends, your students, or your constituents. Being a steward could be over a place like your home, your church, your neighborhood, your job, or your school. It could be a thing like your health, your ministry, your credit, your emotions, your habits, or your studies. But make no mistake about it, child of God, being a Christian steward forces us to realize that everything we have derives its origin from God. And because it comes from God, then God has given you and I some instructions on how we must take good care of what God has given to us. Pat yourself on the chest and say, I got to learn to take good care of what God's given me. I have to learn to take good care of what God has given me. Now again, what I love about following the ways of Jesus is that when I'm trying to learn that which I do not know, I do not have to look very far for an example. Because the same way God takes care of me, I argue, is the way God would ask us to take care of one another. The same God that forgives me would ask me to make sure I forgive you. The same God that helps me would ask me to make sure that I help you. The same God that sacrificed everything to give me the chance to have life and life eternal would say to me that I have to make sure that I put everything on the table for the sake of my brother, my sister, that thing that has been left in my charge. The book of Jude, then, is a powerful declaration and description of the kind of steward that God has said or described God's self to be for us. And I want to open this up a little bit because I believe that there's a very powerful, powerful description of who God is in relationship to who you and I can be. Because again, if God is taking care of me, then I'm never in a place of fear that I am not taking care of me.
Right. Okay.
The middle of the text then lifts up verse number 24. It says, now to him who is able. First thing that I want you to know and believe and be comforted by, and stop tripping when you feel like you are left without some help, is that you serve a God who is able. Somebody holler, God is able.
God is able.
Now understand, child of God, God being able is also a declaration on everybody else. Because how many of you know God's version of being able is different than yours or mine?
Lord, I wish I had an honest church in here today.
Tell your neighbor, you are not as able as God. I just want you to know that. Amen. I know you sophisticated. You got your PhDs and MDs. You got your nice deep bank account. But tell them again, you are not as able as God. Amen. How many know that God can take some things that everybody else thinks are impossible?
Amen. Amen.
And God knows how to turn that situation into an opportunity for him to get some glory. Somebody holler, God is able. Don't you know, my brother and my sister, that when you believe that God is able to take care of you, then there's nothing that comes against you that will cause you to lose your faith.
Amen.
It don't mean I may not get rocked. Come on, y'all, like some, like boxing, praise God. I was watching Muhammad Ali. Amen. Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. I just love the compilations they put together on this brother. Because this was one fast and just talented brother who shook up the world. But you see that towards the latter part of Muhammad's career, There are a few times he got rocked. But there was something on the inside of Brother Muhammad that seemed to always allow him to bounce back.
That's right, that's right.
This week, some of y'all need that bouncing back.
Come on.
Power. Because life will rock you. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Life will put you in some circumstance, situation where you're trying to scratch your head and figure out, God, but I'm fasting and I pray. Why me? Why is this happening to me? In the middle of all of those circumstances and situations, you need to remind yourself that God is able.
Yeah.
There is no temptation, no trial, no tribulation that has happened to you, but such as is common to all of us. And even in those moments when you're feeling like you are falling and feeling like you are without help, God wants to remind you that even in the middle of those moments, God can do anything but
fail.
Because God is able. The challenging part is not about God being able. The challenging part is about us continuing to because, truth be told, followers of God get amnesia the most.
Because
there's a lot of competing narratives out there. We was with the kids at the Church of God in Christ convention this past weekend and doing some Lifelines training with them. And it's so amazing how our young people, many of us in this room, are the same. You know, we are unaware of the competing narratives that are always in our minds, calling into question the ability for God to do what God said. So we talking to the kids, and you know, they're in their minds. They talking about how, you know, they don't listen to all the music out there for the words, but they listen to the music for the beat. I'm listening to the beat. It's not the words. It's not, you know, the words that are calling, you know, my sisters and my mom's H's and B's. I'm not listening to the music because of that. I'm not listening to the music because it's telling me to blow my fellow human beings' brains out because they, you know, disrespect me. I'm listening to the beat. I said, wait, that's a, how come when I pull over your iPad, you ain't never just got a beat? Some of the mamas listening to it today. So I'm like, oh. But I told him, I said, you know, ain't it something that competing narrative that's in your mind is always trying to uncouple or destroy the narrative of God in your life?
That's true. Don't get mad at God.
So God's telling you to be in a monogamous relationship, and you sitting there, I want to be faithful. Uh-huh. But every time that narrative starts to play in your mind, it ain't talking to you about no faithfulness.
Right.
I'm trying to be nonviolent. But every time that narrative starts playing in your mind, it ain't talking about nonviolence.
Right.
I'm trying to be content. But every time that narrative starts playing in your mind, we got competing narratives in our minds. And let's not even bring in real life, because how many don't have that music in them but Fantasy Island run them up? But you'll be surrounded by people when circumstances happen in your life, and they will call into question God's ability to take care of you.
Yes.
You remember the story of Job when Job got sick? And Job's friends, rather than encouraging Job, told Job, God has obviously walked out on you. Because you sinned, you did something, God is upset with you. Lord, save me from friends.
Right.
Who can only see the and not the possibility.
Come on.
That God is gonna throw me away, cause I make a mistake. God keeps you from unfolding this, that even when you make a mistake, he knows how to.
Yes.
Put it back in reverse. The theological term for that is called redemption.
Yes.
It's called restoration. God knows how to redeem your life from destruction.
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
Part of the process of you being kept from falling is to be honest about the things that make you fall. Now it's always easy to rejoice about God delivering. Oh, thank you, Jesus. About what's keeping you falling.
Come on, come on, come on.
Some of you can't stop tripping because you're not even aware of what's got you falling. Thinking back to my days of drug and alcohol counseling, when we used to counsel the brothers and the sisters who were in rehab, trying to kick their addictions. And we talked about these things called imprints that are in your mind, unconscious triggers that you are often not even aware of. And research has now gotten so sophisticated that those triggers are being associated now with race and gender and class and sexual orientation and religion and all of these categories that we have created in this world to divide one another up so we can't see each other's full humanity. So we got these triggers in our mind that are often unconscious, that when you say a certain thing, you got an unconscious trigger going on in your mind that will start you tripping. You try to figure out, why am I tripping? Because you got some unconscious stuff, right? Okay. Going on in your mind. Some of us are being led by our unconscious. When God wants you to be aware, actively aware of what he is doing in your life.
Come on.
The research says that when you start to deal with those unconscious anxieties, that you can actually account for them and be free from them. I'll give you a quick example of an imprint. How many of you remember the first time you, let me see, if we in church, so I got to do something down on the outside. We was at my meeting, and I asked the kids, how many of y'all carry guns? This is at the church meeting. Kids start looking around like, and it took a few minutes, but you know, turned out that a bunch of them carrying guns. Kids filled with the Holy Ghost and power. God save us from lying in the church. Give the neighbor a high five and tell them I'm gonna stop lying in the church. Thank you, Jesus. I'm asking God to let me be from the lying spirit at church. Amen. How about your first birthday?
There you go.
I remember your most significant birthday. Amen. I forget y'all. Let me just use myself. Yeah. Okay. you know, we was in high school, and you know, my parents put us in Christian school, so you know, we didn't get a chance to do a whole lot of crazy stuff. So I remember the first time we went to the black and white ball. Praise God. And when I was walking in, they were playing Belle Biv DeVoe. And you know what? Every time I hear Belle Biv and DeVoe, DVD. My mind goes back to that black and white ball.
Yes, sir.
I don't ask my mind to go back. I don't say mind, oh, DVD. Let's go back to it. Just automatically takes me back.
Yes. Yes.
Some of us in here got unconscious triggers.
Yes. Mm.
You smell a certain thing and it takes you back to him or her.
Yeah.
You hear a certain thing, you go to a certain place, and it starts to take you back to places where you start tripping.
Yeah.
I thought God delivered me from that. He did. But it's still imprinted in your mind. That's why the scripture says, I call on you, my brothers and sisters, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed, listen, by the renewing of your mind.
Yes.
See, you can't keep the same mind and expect not to be tripping.
Come on.
God has to reprogram some things in your mind. God has to reprogram some things in your belief system. Why? Because that is what's been causing you to trip all along. So part of the deliverance process of God, when he's saying that I will keep you from falling, it is not just the case when you are falling, Lord have mercy, but I hear God saying that I want to do a preemptive work in your life. I want to do a prevention work in your life. How? By deprogramming you from those things that are causing you to fall over and over and over again. I know somebody put in your heart that you'll never be anybody, but God said, I'm getting ready to reverse.
Yeah.
a worse thing. And then I don't know if we had a rusty, amen, a rusty wash machine, amen. Because, you know, sometimes you pour that Clorox in there and then it comes out with a yellow tin or something like that. Anybody ever have that? Amen. Thank you for your honest view, folk. Amen. Still got the lion spirit. I said that.
Mm-hmm.
Understanding of God is not a prerequisite for God's movement in your
Amen.
Life.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, I have found that those times when I don't understand God is precisely when God is trying to move. God, I don't understand why you keep putting me in this situation. Maybe God's trying to move something inside. I don't understand why this circumstance continues to, maybe God is trying to move some things. Why am I here, God? I'm tired of being in this place. Maybe because you are not ready to move to the next place yet. None of us want to be in heaven, but no, none of us want to die. What does that mean? A lot of us want to experience the great mountaintop blessing, but we don't want to take the trip up the mountain. A lot of us want to be in the next phase of our life, but we can't handle the one we're in. First things first. Somebody holler, first things first.
First things first.
Believe that God's got you. If you can live your life like God's got you, there is no devil in hell that can stop a child of God when God's got your back.
Amen.
Stand with me, everyone.
We'll be right back.